Beegle was born into a migrant labor family where no one was educated beyond the eighth grade. For generations, her family subsisted on menial wage employment and migrant work. Although they worked hard, they were constantly evicted, hungry, and struggling with poverty. By the time she was 12, Donna had learned from her extended family the body of knowledge passed from generation to generation that defines survival in poverty nation. Which churches and agencies give out free clothes and shoes? Where were the dumpsters where she could get returnable cans and bottles without getting caught? Where could she go for help when her utilities were being shut off? How, when she was sick, was she able to get free medicine samples from an emergency room? And being the only member in her family who has not been incarcerated, she knew the rules at a very young age for visiting people in prison and how to find out to which jail your relatives were taken. By the age of 15, she had dropped out of school, married, and worked in a rubber foam factory as a migrant worker and in other menial jobs. At the age of 25, she had two children, was divorced, and homeless. And then she learned of a pilot program connected to a community college, which was geared toward helping single women gain education or skills to earn a living. As a result of that program, she earned her GED, and then within 10 years, received her doctorate in educational leadership. For more than 25 years, Dr. Beegle has traveled throughout hundreds of cities in 47 states and 4 countries to assist professionals with proven strategies for breaking poverty barriers. State agencies, politicians, and other organizations have partnered with her to implement community-wide approaches to improving outcomes for citizens in poverty. Through the services provided by her consulting company, Communication Across Barriers, which she founded with her mentor in 1989, she speaks, writes, and trains across the world to break the iron cage of poverty for others. She is also the author of See Poverty Be the Difference, and an action approach to educating students who live in the crisis of poverty. Dr. Beegle's inspiring story of moving from 28 years of homelessness to achieving a doctorate and her groundbreaking work assisting people to move out of poverty has been featured on the internet, in newspapers, and on television around the nation. She is presently completing a PBS documentary with award-winning producer George Rivera and was featured on CNN in the Other America segment. Dr. Beegle has also received numerous awards for sharing her personal story and experiences. In 2008, she was named the National Speaker of the Year for the New Mexico Bar Foundation. And in 2011, she won the Oregon Ethics and Business Award. In 2013, Donna was named Woman of Influence by the Portland Business Journal and received the Orchid Award, which honors women who are compelling, affecting change, and representing their positions with strength, wisdom, and grace. Just recently, Dr. Beegle was named a prestigious Woodrow Wilson Fellow, which has graciously provided the opportunity for her to visit our campus tonight. Undoubtedly, Dr. Donna Beegle is an authentic voice from poverty that inspires and educates individuals, organizations, politicians, and entire communities with proven models to better outcomes for people in poverty. Will you please join me in welcoming her to Wingate University?
Someone share with me, and you have to shout it out. So what would this community look like if it was visible that the thing you care about the most is children? What would I see? Better housing. All through my life, the houses that we could get were condemned or should have been. And people would scream at me and say, "Why is your electric bill $500? And I'd be like, "I don't know. I think we're dumb." But now that I've studied poverty for the last 25 years, what I know is the houses we could get, the ice was usually on the inside of the windows, with no heat, with using burners to heat the place. So, substandard housing. Why is it okay for landlords to rent substandard housing? People who are in the crisis of poverty are not going to call up the city and say, "Hey, we're renting this house and the roof's falling in and there's no plumbing." They'll be like my dad. They'll be like, "Don't worry about that roof falling in. Yeah, no, I'm a handyman. I'll get it fixed right up." Who in here has ever been part of somebody doing some remodeling? You think we're going to fix it? It's expensive. We're going to duct tape it. It's going to get worse, and then we'll be evicted or we'll move. So when I teach about poverty, what I focus on is how do we separate the poverty from our fellow human beings? How do we ensure that we are actually fighting the poverty and not fighting the people who live in it? What else would I see? I would see great houses for kids. What else would I see? Lots of laughter and places to play. I flew into a community the other day and I asked the superintendent of schools, I was doing some in-service for his teachers, so I said to him, what do kids do for fun around here? And he said, drink and drive? Really? No, like, roller skating or something? Think about a kid in poverty. What can they do if they don't have any money? How much the movie cost? So are there things for kids to do that don't cost any money? When I was in poverty, people would say, I'm not going to give you a scholarship for your kids to go to the swimming pool because you can't pay anything. And we believe the parents should have to pay something or they won't value it. And at this point in my life, I'm living on $408 a month. My rent is $395. Who's good at math? How much did I have left? $13. What did I have to do with that $13? Utilities, transportation. They did give me $150 in food stamps. And by the way, right now you will see and hear in the media a ton of rhetoric about we got to cut food stamps. The majority of people receive food stamps are people with disabilities, elderly and children, and the working poor. Majority of people who are in poverty are working. And if you're on food stamps today, you get $1.47 per meal. So what are you going to buy? You're going to buy the carbs, the starches, the foods that really stretch far. Because typically, if you're in generational poverty, they're not just going for you. The food is going for your cousin who doesn't have the right ID to get her own food, or for your brother or your friend who doesn't have a way to get to the food stamp office. So it stretches, the subsistence stretches even farther. So you'll hear people in ignorance saying, we don't have hunger in America, we have obesity, which really shows our ignorance about what people can buy who live in the war zone of poverty. I asked this question earlier, but I'll ask it again. How many of you buy healthy food? And who would be willing to testify under oath it's expensive? So you can begin to see why we see some of the obesity rates that we see in our country, because you're not going to have access. And another part of the access, of course, is you have a store to go to. Where do most people in poverty shop? Does anyone know? Gas station stores, 7-Elevens, they pay more for milk, they pay more for bread. There's tremendous studies showing that people who are in poverty pay more for their basics than people who have. And some of that has to do with the location of the stores, the transportation issues that you also face. So if we really valued children, we would have things for them to do. Things to keep them busy and occupied and learning and growing and part of their community. What else would we see if we really valued children? Good schools. It wouldn't be like today where I can go to any city in the United States and I can call a real estate agent and say, where are the good schools? How many of you know you can do that? Which means we know what? Not every kid is getting the same chance. But that's what we teach in our country. Everyone has the same chance. No, I beg to differ. Some people are born with a pillow to lay their head on, to educated parents, to stability, to nutrition, to transportation needs being met, to health needs being met. And others are born, like me, to parents who can't read and write, who had a worse life than we had. So not everyone starts the same. And it's happening today. It's not an old story. We have schools that have 100% of their kids in the crisis of poverty. And typically it's very concentrated like that. So you go into a community and you'll see, you know, 70, 80, 90% of the kids are in poverty. And then there's schools where there's 1% or 2%. And those kids are getting a completely different education, a completely different focus. And then when they come out, we go, why don't you just do what they do? Not, wow, we didn't prepare you. So we would have excellent, wouldn't we have excellent preschool, not only like K-12, but wouldn't we have excellent preschool if we really valued our children? We would have excellent preschool, not just for the kids who have, but for all children. Because we know about brain development. We know about how important and critical it is that early learning. Yet our program for addressing that is the Head Start program, which works. It's an excellent model. It came out of Johnson's War on Poverty. It actually works. But guess what we do? We underfund it. So half of all the four-year-olds in America who qualify, there's no space for them. We turn them away. And then when they get into kindergarten, their vocabulary is farther behind. Kids who go to Head Start are more ready to learn. They're more likely to complete their education. So here's a model we know that works, but we don't invest in it as a community, as a nation. What would your community look like if I were to land here and I could see visibly that the thing you care the most about are your senior citizens? Housing. I was doing an opportunity community, which I'm going to share a little bit more about that model, in a community, and there was a woman who, when I got to her, she said, it doesn't matter. I'm 70 years old. There's nothing I can do. Every month, I make choices between whether to pay my trailer space payment or pay my copay on my medicine. She lives on $650 a month. So think about that. People making those kinds of choices who are senior citizens and living in trailers with no insulation. What else would I see if we really cared about our senior citizens? Wouldn't they, we wouldn't be talking about, hey, you can't get your medicine because you don't have your copay. Somebody sent me an email the other day that they were in line behind someone at a pharmacy, and his medicine, I think, was like $92, and his Medicaid card or whatever card he had for health insurance would pay for $89, but he didn't have $3. So they sent him away without very critical medicine that he needed. So we would have true health care to get people's needs met, like many, many other countries do. We're the only industrialized nation that doesn't have health care for our people, even currently as we're merging into a new era with Affordable Care Act. We still are not there yet. We're closer, but we're not there yet for people actually being able to afford preventative care, dental care. I thought your teeth belonged in a cup after the age of 30. I didn't know that people lived past 60. Because people in poverty, they die at a much younger age than people who are born into a privileged context. And a lot of people will say, well, they die young because they drink too much, they smoke too much, and they don't take care of themselves. The federal government did a study a few years back looking at early deaths by social class. And they found 13% of those deaths could be attributed to drinking, smoking, or not taking care of yourself. Majority of the deaths were attributed to living in polluted neighborhoods, working in unsafe jobs, the lack of access to health care, and the stress of poverty itself, which the researchers have now discovered affects your immunity, so you're sick a whole lot more. And it also kills short-term memory cells. So that war zone of poverty is impacting humans in some really significant physical ways. So about 87% of the deaths are attributed to preventable reasons. Some people will say, well, they're in poverty, Donna, because they're child abusers. They're sex abusers. They're drug addicts. They're alcoholics. Those are the reasons, people will tell you, that cause poverty. Show of hands, who here has ever heard of a wealthy alcoholic? Who's ever heard of a middle-class drug addict? These are not poverty issues. These issues cross class. They're in all social classes. If you look at celebrities, I used to bring in, to prove this point, because people would come up to me and they said, well, they're poor because they're drug addicts, drunks, sex offenders, child abusers, domestic violence, and I was like, wow, I'm taking every social ill in humanity and put it on people who have no voice, who don't vote. So I would bring in celebrity magazines just to prove the point, and I would say, look what he did, look what she did. You know, see Britney, you see Justin, Paris. Drug addiction, alcoholism, not poverty issues. The group that suffers with the highest numbers of incidents of the disease of alcoholism is actually attorneys. It's not people in poverty. But alcoholism is a disease. So if I'm privileged and I have resources, I can go get treatment. Like Britney Spears, she paid $40,000 a month for her treatment for alcoholism. What if I'm in poverty? Most people in poverty don't get treatment for that disease. What they get is, if they get arrested, they'll get detox for 2 or 3 hours, and then they're sent back out on the streets with that disease. And we continue to treat it like a behavior. We say, stop it. You gotta love your kids more. It's a disease. We have research showing it's a disease that requires treatment. And currently, the treatment for alcoholism that's consistent with the literature is $90,000. That's what it costs. So is someone in poverty going to get that? Drug addiction, not a poverty issue. Sex offense, does that happen in privileged homes? Domestic violence. Those issues... Child abuse, they happen in all social classes, but see, when you're in poverty, you got a spotlight on your family and your behavior, because you're complying with all of these organizations to get your crisis needs met. So for the middle class person who struggles with alcoholism or domestic violence, they've got places to hide. If you're in poverty, you're right out there with the spotlight on you. So, but they get attributed to, it's those people. We fight the people, not the poverty issues, not the lack of access to treatment if you do have an addiction, or the issue of mental health. If you're in poverty and you struggle with mental health, what do you do? I mean, that's an issue that crosses all social classes. But again, if you have resources and supports, you can get treatment and you can have whatever addressed. Whereas if you're in poverty, it usually just spirals worser. My mentor, who taught me to be bilingual and speak middle class language, he said, Donna, when you're tired, your grammar will revert. And it does. I am bilingual. I speak fluent middle class language, but I grew up saying ain't every other word, not knowing when to say gone or went, not knowing how people knew when to say seen or saw. I grew up not knowing the words that people would use, the vocabulary that they would use. I was sharing an instructor when I was working on my GED at 26. He said, he was talking about Watergate, and I said, so what is Watergate? And he said, how can you not know this? Aren't you an American? And I was just mortified. I'm like, I don't know why I don't know what you seem to know, and everybody seems to know. I must be dumb. And that's really what happens to people who live in the crisis of poverty. They internalize that personal deficiency. Something's wrong with me. But you don't really know what, because America teaches you that everyone starts the same. So what that meant to me is, I thought everyone grew up with parents who couldn't read and write. I thought everyone got evicted. I thought everyone did without basic food. I thought I invented nachos because we would get the government cheese and the chips and I put them in the oven. And that was all we had to eat. That or maybe a spoon of peanut butter. But I thought everyone was having that life, and somehow because they were more intelligent or more moral or more ethical or more something, they found a way out. I was 26 years old when I first heard the life stories of middle-class folks. And I was in this pilot welfare-to-work program. And there were four women in the program who stood up and told their life stories. And I'm sitting in the chair, 26 years old, have major attitude, have big-time smart mouth, which poverty teaches you both. I mean, think about it. If you watch your grandma do without her medicine, would you get an attitude? If you watch your mom go hungry, would you maybe get a little bit of a smart mouth? So what I teach is there's a reason for that attitude. There's a reason for that smart mouth. So I validate it. When I work with folks in poverty, I just say, how many of you have an attitude? They're like, you bet we do. Anybody here got a smart mouth? You bet. Good. Because if you didn't, I'd be worried about you. Anybody who does without their basic human needs should have an attitude. And then I teach them how to channel it so that they use it in ways that don't hurt them or get them shut off from resources. So these four women stood up and told their life stories, and I heard them say things like they lived in one house their whole childhood. They went to one school. Their parents were educated. They owned not only their home, but they had a vacation home. They went on vacations. They had car insurance. They had financial planners to help with finances and filing taxes. They had inheritance. They had credit. And pretty soon, as I'm listening to their stories, I'm thinking, no wonder you get to be on that side of the table. And it was that moment for me, that was a pivotal moment, when I was able to just go, you're not better than me. You just had different experiences and different exposure. So then I could write in my little brown diary, I'm going to try to get that GED they're talking about. Then maybe I'll be somebody. Because poverty teaches you you're not. Nobody calls you by your name. Nobody looks up when you walk in a room. I was training Department of Human Services, and this particular building was 5 blocks long, one address. So I go into the only door. I finally like, okay, maybe the training center's in this door. So I go in the door, and I'm in the welfare waiting room. So I see grandmas and moms and dads and uncles and cousins and people there, so elderly, trying to get their crisis needs met. And I go up to the counter, and I wait, because I've, by this point in my life, learned middle-class norms, which is you wait, and I wait, and I wait, and I wait. And there's a man, and he's just writing, and he's not looking up. So I finally said, excuse me. Excuse me, I'm lost. Is there a training center around here somewhere?
Don't know.
A lady comes walking from behind a cubicle, and I said, excuse me. Another lady comes out, excuse me. She stops because I terrified her. I said, can you help me? I'm looking for a training center. Is there a training center here somewhere? She said, well, yeah, there is. There's one down on the southwest corner of the building. And I said, thank you. So what do? I go out this door right. She's gone. I don't usually get treated like that in my current life. I get presents in my room with cards. So happy to see you. I show up and people are like, Dr. Beegle, we can't believe you're here. This is so awesome. We've been waiting 2 years to get you. That's how I get treated. But that's how I want everyone to be treated. Can you imagine if we treated everyone who lives in the war zone of poverty like that? You're here? I get to work with you? I get you in my class? I know people at first would be like, weirdo. But there's a concept in communication theory called honoring. It's that sense of self that is built from people noticing you, that feeling that you too can belong. You're wanted. So the executive director of that particular organization, she said to me, well, how was your trip? We're so excited to see you. And I said, it was really good until I got here. And I told her how I was treated. Because if I'm being treated that way, how are the people who live in the crisis of poverty being treated? Probably worse. So at the break, she came up to me and she said, Donna, I went over and told them where we were in case someone else went through that door. And I was treated the same way. So I've called the manager. They're going to do a performance review. And I said, you know, I'm not about anybody losing their job, but I'm all about helping people understand you must treat people with dignity. Because how many of you know that helping professionals have power over people who live in the crisis of poverty? The tone of voice of a teacher can impact a kid's self-esteem. The way the janitor talks to the kid can impact them. The social worker, the health worker, the person in the justice system, the person in the business community, all have power to shape how that person feels. One of my best friends is an African-American man who grew up in generational poverty in Camden, New Jersey. And Camden's famous for a lot of things, like rated the worst city in the United States multiple times. And Sharif was growing up in deep generational poverty, which we have that in common, which is why we can finish each other's sentences. Sharif spent about 38 years of his life pretty much homeless. I spent about 28 years of my life pretty much homeless. So I don't have to explain things to him about the context of poverty like I have to do for folks who haven't experienced it. So I told him one time, Sharif, I got some friends who want me to go camping. What do you think? And he's like, oh yeah, leave the warm bed, go sleep on the ground, woohoo! See, he gets it. Because we were never homeless, we were always camping. We just didn't have the right stuff to be out there. Except one time, when I was 10 years old, we were camping in Forestville, California. And all of a sudden, we had a tent, a Coleman stove, lantern, really cool sound lantern. We had sleeping bag, we had the stuff we needed to be out there. And the stress levels in our family went way down because we had the right stuff to be out there. But it only lasted for 2 weeks, and then the police came and they took my brother Melvin, who was 14, who had broken into a camping store, and all the camp gear. So Sharif told this story. He comes and speaks at my poverty institutes. I hire him to come because he's a brilliant inclusivity trainer worldwide, works on racism. We've worked together for 25 years. He wrote a book called A World That Works for All. And you can see his work at commonway.org. He's incredible. So he comes to my institute and he shared this story of when he was in junior high and junior high counselor told him that he wasn't college material. So he needed to figure out what he could do with his hands. So here's this kid in deep poverty, facing both racism and poverty, being told this. And Sharif said when he got to high school, a high school counselor came up to him and said, what college are you thinking of going to? And Sharif said, I repeated what the junior high counselor said. I'm not college material. I have to work with my hands. And he said, that high school counselor said two words that changed my life. She said, bullshit. He went on to become an attorney. When I met him, he said he was doing penance for being an attorney for 10 years. He was running a low-income housing project where he would take the people who were going to live in the low-income housing and he would walk through empty fields and he would say, when you get home, what do you do first? And they'd say things like, well, I go hang up my coat. And the architects are behind drawing where a place for them to hang their coat. What else do you do? I go get a cup of coffee. They're drawing the kitchen. They're drawing the homes to meet the needs of the people. which he's just brilliant. So he's worked for 6 years in Sri Lanka on the peace movement and worked all over the world, and including in the United States on racism. We actually, he and I have recently been invited to come and work with Ferguson. So we'll be going there and talking about the poverty and race issues there. So, but think about this man who's written multiple books, worked around the world. What would happen if not for that high school teacher? I mean, counselor, what would happen? Would I know him, or would he be on this track? So we have to be careful what we say to people, because our words hold so much power. When I was 15, I quit school, and I told my teacher, I'm so out of here. This stuff has nothing to do with me. And my teacher said, now, you don't want to quit school, because one day you're going to want a job. Raise your hand if you think that's a good motivator. Most people would say, yeah, it's a good motivator. What I teach, meanings are in people, not words. Words are just symbols. We give them meaning based on our lived experience. So what do you think the meaning of a job is to a teacher? Probably not a job, right? A career. Probably have food in your fridge. Probably, you're not, teachers are not overpaid by any means. But probably have food in your fridge, transportation needs met, health needs met. Maybe can take a vacation once in a while. So the teacher thinks she's giving me an incentive to stay in school, a motivator to stay in school. But what do you think the meaning of a job is to a migrant labor worker? I never knew a soul who benefited from education. I never knew a soul who used education to earn a living. I never heard the word career. The meaning of a job was you don't get treated with respect, you don't move up, you still get evicted, you still go hungry. So in my mind at 15, the only thing I could see that a job did for anyone was take them away from their family who were in crisis and needed them. How many of you would leave your family if they were in crisis? Especially to go to a place where you don't earn enough to pay your rent and your utilities. So I looked at my teacher at 15 and said, I don't want a job. And how does a middle-class person respond to that? Value, judge, attribute, motive. We say, she said, you're lazy, and you're not motivated, and you're not going to go anywhere in life with that little attitude. I went from GED to doctorate in 10 years. And I often hear people say that about people in the crisis of poverty. They're not motivated. They're not determined. And I say, you're not using the right motivators. When I talk to kids in poverty, I'm like, hey, how'd you like to buy your grandma a house? How'd you like to never, ever, ever see your mom go hungry again? I'm going to tell you two ways you can do that. Get educated, get skilled. Because that's what our labor market demands. And then I'm going to break it down for them in terms of how you can do that. I was talking to several hundred kids at an alternative ed school, and I said to the kids there, they were doing some really amazing things. It was great effort there. And I said, who's talking to you all about college? You could hear a pin drop. I said, are you kidding me? No one's talking to you about college in a labor market that demands an education or a skill for a living wage? And this one high school boy stood up and said, did you forget you're at the alternative school? So I said, all right, listen to me. I took algebra 4 times. I got a D every single time. I didn't know what a D meant. But I finally asked my professor, does D mean passing? And he said, yes, but you're going to want to come back, take that class again so you can get those skills. And I said, no, I don't. I'm done. And I've never had this phone call. 25 years of doing this work. Dr. Beegle, yes, we'd like to hire you to come and keynote for us, but first, what did you get in algebra? What I teach kids is you don't have to be perfect. Don't strive for a D. Do your best, ask for help, but don't shut that door on a labor market that demands a skill or an education. So the messages around poverty that come from helping professionals, you go into welfare offices, you see signs that say things like, you choose welfare, you choose work. I go in to do poverty competency assessments and I say, I can think of 1,000 ways to say that nicely. How about you just found some great resources for earning a living for your family? The research shows that kids who go to more high poverty schools are treated very differently than kids who go to privileged schools. The exact same behavior is defined differently by social class. Schools with more poverty concentrate on discipline and control. Schools of privilege really concentrate on teaching students to challenge and question. The kid in poverty that challenges and questions told they're deviant, suspended. The kid in privilege that challenges and questions told they have leadership characteristics. I go work with schools, I do a ton of work with schools, and I go 2 blocks away from the school with the administrators, and I give them a clipboard and a piece of paper, and I say, just write down what you see and what it makes you feel. Because about 2 blocks away from the schools with the most poverty, you'll start seeing, no, don't, stop, kinds of signs. Go to schools of privilege, you'll see, welcome, dare to dream, be all you can be. One school, I did this with the administrators, and we walked in to the building, they had their clipboards, the very first classroom said, excuses, stop at the door. Second classroom had the dress code. Third classroom said, no students allowed till class time. The school had 100% of its kids living in crisis of poverty. And I said, is this really the message you want to give kids who already believe education is not for people like them? So we brought the kids in, and I said, what do you feel? When you see that sign, excuses stop at the door, what are you feeling? And this one boy said, take my beating and shut up. We don't have to beat people down. They're already down. We got to lift them up. But we can't lift them up if we're ignorant about poverty. If we don't understand, there's so many different life experiences of poverty. So poverty can feel overwhelming, not only to the people who live in it, but to the people who serve people who live in it, to the people who are impacted by poverty in our communities. But it's really important to understand that we live in a nation of wealth. We live in a nation of wealth. In the height of the recession, Americans spent $33 billion on pet toys. In 1 month this year, we spent $1.5 billion on video games. We spend $34,000 per year to put one human in a cage, and it's double if they're an adult. We spend $65,000 a year for a kid to be in foster care. We spent billions of dollars on hand sanitizers. There's enough in our communities. There's enough in our government. There's enough land. There's enough food. It's just how do we allocate it is the problem. So what we want to do is really be able to step back and say, what's in my hands? What can I do right now, with my knowledge, my skills, my networks of support, what can I do? And who do I know? How might they help? And who do they know? How might they help? But it all really begins with getting an understanding of the poverty, so we're separating the people from the poverty. Who picked up on what my mom was most proud of? Her kids, right? My parents never went to a school conference. What do we say about those parents? Whose perspective is that? It's a middle class looking in at behavior perspective. And how do we get to that logic? We say things like, if my kid had a school conference, I would be there. And that means that I care and love my kids. So if you don't do what I do, do you see how the logic falls apart? My mom would say, I ain't going in there to make a fool out of myself. Those people want to talk about school. Don't know anything about school. But if one educator had actually said to my mom, tell me about Larry or Melvin or Rick or Wayne or Steve or Donna, I can guarantee you that I'd feel sorry for that educator. She'd still be there talking. Pride and joy. And what was she proud her kids could do? We can sweep and mop. So the takeaway here is, how do expectations get set? Could you imagine that conversation in a middle-class home? I'm so happy all my kids can sweep and mop. The parents can't teach kids something they've never been exposed to themselves. So we blame and judge the parents when they've probably had a worse life than the kids. So this documentary, when it comes out, it will be an hour long, and they're talking about releasing it as a training tool, which I'm really excited about. When we find out the air date, we will post it on our website. And you can just Google my name to get our website, or look at the articles that you had, I think, a chance to pre-read. But Donna Beegle will get you to my website. There's also a free newsletter you can sign up for, and you can get information regularly about best practices that are happening in schools, in health, in social service, in justice. You could get stories of people who are changing lives. What can we do? I developed a model called the Opportunity Community Model. And in this model, I go into a community and I do a community-wide training for anybody you can get there. Chamber of Commerce, business, United Way, healthcare, social service, justice, educators, higher ed, early ed, so that you get the community with some shared language about generational poverty, working class poverty, immigrant poverty, situational poverty. So many different life experiences defined as one word, poverty. So a man in my doctoral study, I wanted people who grew up in poverty who achieved a bachelor's degree. A man said to me, I'll do your study for you. I grew up in poverty. And I said, well, tell me, how did your family get by? He said, well, my father was a physician. He died when I was only 12, and I had to go live with my grandparents and work in their store, pulled myself up, and I became a doctor like my dad. And I'm listening to him from generational poverty perspective, from living that context. And I'm thinking, you knew someone who owned a store? And you were related to them? That's not poverty. But you got to look at it from his context, who the children or professionals hang out with. And what we humans do is we compare ourselves to the people around us. So if you grew up with people around you who have more, highly likely you internalize that you grew up poor. Another guy told me, well, we grew up poor, we had nothing. I said, well, how did you get by? Well, we had a cattle ranch, but it was a small one. So the guy who was having a physician for a father, even for 12 years, he's not thinking about what that did for his vocabulary, his sentence structure, his exposure to possibilities, his networks of support, his inheritance. So how's he likely to treat someone in generational or working class poverty? Probably like, hey, I did it, why can't? So getting poverty informed requires that foundational understanding. Also in the opportunity community, one of the components of it is I do a huge conference for people who currently live in poverty. And the components are remove the shame that poverty teaches, that paralyzes people from grabbing an opportunity. How do I do that? I teach them they're not the cause of poverty. I teach them real causes of poverty. I tell them, your personality is not the cause of poverty. If it were, you'd be the only one in it, not 49 million people. And I tell them, if you don't get educated or skilled, you're going to be poor your whole life, and so will your kids. And people will tell me, you're the first person who ever told us the truth. And I show them the facts. And then people will say, I'm not smart enough to go to school. I don't know the words there. I don't know what they're talking about. So I show them a failing report card. I say, is this person going to college? And they're like, no. No, in fact, this person couldn't read at 15. By 19, she had her associate's degree. And then she got her bachelor's degree. And then she got her master's degree. And then she got accepted into the doctoral program. This was my cousin who was 15 who came to live with me at 15. Her mom makes an X for her name. What people know when you meet them isn't all they can know. It's just what they've been exposed to. I met a 17-year-old sleeping in a skate park. And I said, so what's going on with you in school? He said, I'm not good at it. I said, really? He said, yeah, I don't know. I don't follow through. And I know he's not telling me what he thinks. He's telling me what he's been told. So I said, I've known you 5 minutes. I can tell you're a really bright guy. What didn't work for you? He said, didn't like my teacher and she didn't like me. And I said, you know, that can happen. I dropped out of school at 15. I got my GED when I was 26. He said, 26? Man, I'm glad to hear that because I'm 17. I thought it was too late. Because that's what we teach kids in crisis, that they have to do this linear path. I said, no, it's not too late, and you're getting a doctorate. Let's get you going. And I believe it. And people know if you believe in them. The potential is unlimited for people. I could not write a complete sentence at 26. I thought the whole page meant paragraph. Teachers were always writing fragment, run-on. I didn't know what that meant. And they made assumptions that somebody out there would tell me. I learned at 28 from my mentor at University of Portland. He said, let me show you what a fragment is. And he showed me and showed me another way and showed me another way. And I'm like, oh, I get it now. All those red marks, all those years. He had me read the newspaper. He said, I'm going to help you become bilingual. You need to read the newspaper. I was 26. I'd never read a newspaper. I said, I can't read the newspaper. I don't know the words in there. I don't know what they're talking about. He said, circle anything you don't know. Come to my class. Come to my office. So I would bring it in there, big old stacks of newspaper with all these things circled, and he would dialogue with me, and he would use the words in context, and he would explain to me why they were used that way, and pretty soon I'm moving them from short-term memory to long-term memory. He said, you communicate beautifully, and it works for you, but let me give you the language that's going to help you in education in the workplace. So I'd be telling him something, and he'd say, no, you don't say ain't. You meant gone, not went. Have gone, I went. I'm running around the campus going, have gone, I went. Have gone, I went. He never said my way was bad, though. It was always adding value, which is the way mentors should do. So pretty soon I would come in to tell him a story. I'd say something, and he would say, no. And I'd be like, no, it really did happen. I think, and then I would realize I said something not middle-class sentence structure. And sometimes he would help me, and sometimes he would just look at me, and pretty soon I could hear the word, and I would translate before I spoke. And it is true that when I get tired, my grammar reverts, just like someone reverts to their native language. So when I talk about being bilingual, I really do mean that. It's a different style of communication. It's a different sentence structure. It's different vocabulary. It's different references. It's different connections. So what would it look like if I didn't have that mentor, that person who went outside of his job description? And his colleagues at the privileged University of Portland said, it's not your job to teach a junior not to say ain't. She didn't have it by now. She doesn't belong to the university. And Dr. Fulford would say, I go to work every day to educate. And for Donna, it means I need to include this piece. For other students, it means different things. And as I became more and more educated, he would say, did I achieve my goal? And then some. Part of the way I was able to make it through community college is my brother Wayne spent 12 years in prison. And he spent his time reading. So when I got to the community college, I entered a world of words I didn't know, subject matter I'd never heard before. And I was like asking the professors and the instructors, and they would send me to read more. And my people didn't write the dictionary or the textbooks. So I would write Wayne letters in prison, and I would say, we're studying this subject. I got a test in 3 weeks. Find out everything you can. And he'd write me back 25-page letters. He would use familiar vocabulary. He would use examples from our childhood. I'm acing my test. I had a really high GPA. I couldn't read my textbooks until I was a junior, and Dr. Fulford helped me become bilingual. He hired me to be a TA. He said, I want you to do is grade these papers and find the grammatical errors. And I'm like, you trust me? He says, ain't every word, really? And that meant the world, that he trusted me. So I tried so hard, I learned to write. Soon after that, I was so ashamed of my story of poverty, that I wouldn't tell anybody. Nobody at the university knew that I was leaving there and going to sell food stamps to pay the electric bill, running to the food bank to try to get clothes for my kids and food. Nobody knew that. I didn't tell anybody. I know they thought I was weird, because University of Portland's a privileged sister to Notre Dame, and I'm coming on campus 28 years old, I got two kids. I'm driving a big car about the size of this room that was donated to the welfare office. So I knew people thought I was weird, but I didn't tell anybody about my life because I had internalized the shame. And then I went to a meeting for the pilot program where the four women stood up and told their life stories. The four women who began helping me to gain self-confidence and see that I wasn't stupid. And they told me that for every four women who applied, they were turning three of them away because their budgets had been cut. And I thought, oh no, what if they turn me away? I wouldn't be a junior at the university. So I walked into the university, went into my journalism class, and my journalism professor said, hey, Donna, what's news? And I said, I think I'm news. And she said, what's news about you? And so I told her a tiny bit of my life and a whole lot about these people in this pilot program and how they had helped me get housing and transportation and helped me gain self-confidence to start working on my GED. And I told her how they were being cut, and she said, let's make this your assignment. You write this story. And it was the first time I ever wrote about my poverty, and I cried the whole time. Because it's painful. It hurts. And then I took the assignment and I handed it to her, and I wanted it back immediately. Because the last thing in the world I needed was to be pitied or judged. Humans aren't hardwired for pity. Raise your hand if you like it when someone feels sorry for you. Don't raise your hand, it's a mental health issue. Raise your hand if you like it when someone understands you. It's a fundamental human need. So she read it. She said, Donna, this is publishable. You have to take this to the Oregonian. And I said, well, that ain't going to happen. And she said, why not? I said, everyone will know. And she said, Donna, you want to help the people in that program? I'm like, oh. So I drove illegally downtown to the Oregonian. I'm making choices between rent and food. Car insurance is right out there with garbage service on my priority list. So I dropped it off at the Oregonian, and I'm thinking they're not gonna publish it because people write fragments. They won't publish it. Next day I get a phone call from the Oregonian. We're riveted. We want to use this story, and we don't normally pay for it in my opinion columns, but we'd like to pay you because we want to send it out to the AP wire so it can go all over the world. And my first reaction was, everyone's gonna know. And my second reaction was, they like my writing. I learned to write. They like my writing. I still have a copy of that $50 check. So after that, I began speaking on behalf of the Women in Transition program. And when I went back to school and the article came out in the paper, I didn't get pity. I just had people saying, wow, that was an excellent article. I didn't know you went through that. That was really great. And I'm like, really, you like that? I could tell you a little bit more. And so pretty soon I began sharing more and more of my story because I realized it was a great way for people to really begin to understand some of the people they were coming into contact with that they necessarily didn't understand, because we graduate people from college without Poverty 101. So the opportunity community model really gets at that shame, rebuilds that hope. It connects people to a navigator who's been trained about poverty so they're not judging. They gain communication and relationship building skills across social class barriers. We are in 21 states with this model now. And it's designed to be an annual model. So you're constantly matching people, constantly training navigators. And we arm the navigators with specialty navigators, people in the community who can help with a resource or an opportunity. So you might have an attorney who's navigating who says, I'm navigating for somebody who wants to get a GED. Well, they don't have to know how to get a GED because the president of the college has assigned two people, Nancy and Carol, to take the calls of navigators. So all the lawyer has to do is call Nancy or Carol and they'll help them navigate their system. It's breaking down the barriers and the obstacles that people face. If you want to know more about the opportunity community model, shoot me an email. Be happy to send you information on it. It's the thing that I am most proud of, because it helps people get that shame. It helps people get a poverty-oriented community. At the end of my 6 hours with youth or adults in poverty, their language has shifted from "I can't" to "I'm gonna." I'm able to change body posture in about 90 minutes from that beaten down look to that sitting up and able to see, hey, there's nothing wrong with me. There's a lot wrong with poverty. And most of my family members, they'll say, "Donna did it. We can do that." Because they know I'm not perfect. And that's what we have to help people see. The people who are making are not perfect. They make mistakes. Some things they're good at, some things they're not. Because the poverty teaches you the ones who make it are better than you. Two of my brothers now have bachelor's degrees, including Wayne, who spent most of his life in a cage. I have multiple cousins who grew up with parents who make X's for their names, who are entering graduate school. My brother Rick called me this summer and he was sobbing. I thought somebody got hurt. He was sobbing because his son Emmett got a scholarship to a private university. I have a niece who wants to be a paleontologist. This isn't a word we even knew. Generational poverty doesn't have to be. Poverty doesn't have to be in our communities. This is my daughter, Jennifer. Jennifer, at ninth grade, got a full scholarship to a privileged school where she became fluent in French, began writing poetry, directing plays. They sent her to France twice. My son, these are my two boys, Austin and Daniel. And not too long ago, Daniel's dad dropped out of seventh grade. He's not literate. Daniel said, "Mom, I think it's only about 14 years I should have a doctorate." I'm like, oh my gosh. I dropped out of ninth grade. His dad dropped out of seventh. He struggles ADHD. Learning came easy to Jen, tough for him. But he's surrounded by people with doctorates who say, "You can do this." And he knows the people with doctorates aren't perfect humans. They're just people, but the isolation of poverty perpetuates it. So matching neighbors in poverty, students in poverty with navigators who are not, matching them to a poverty-informed community is part of that opportunity community model that's built in. It's all theory-based. So we have judges becoming navigators. We have a woman the other day, she said she's an engineer. She shared that she had built a helicopter with her husband and learned to fly it. And I can't wait to meet my neighbor, give him my phone number, and work with them on their journey to move out and stay out of poverty. So the navigators work for a year with their neighbors in poverty. It's changing lives. We have people who become attorneys, people who become nurses, one homeless guy started a business detailing cars in parking garages while people are at work. He makes $60,000 a year now. We've had people start centers for taking care of babies where there were none before. The human potential is amazing. So if we can get people to a place where they can separate themselves from the poverty and then connect with our communities that are poverty-informed and with people who believe in them, there's no stopping us. We don't have to continue on this path of having the highest number of people in cages, both youth and adult, of having 1 in 5 kids going hungry. Poverty is resolvable. So I want to thank you for having me. I hope I've whet your appetite. I hope you want to know more. I hope you'll read my book, See Poverty Be the Difference. I'm very proud of that book. People are using it. They say they can't put it down. It's got story. It's got best practice. It's got facts to help increase poverty competency. I hope you'll visit my website. I hope some of you will come and join us at our poverty institutes and become certified poverty coaches so that you can teach this stuff. Because I can't do this alone. And if not you, then who? Thank you very much for having me. Thank you.